What's up, Scrollers? It's an Erp here, and the Minecon Open Finals happened this past weekend. In case you haven't seen the official live streams, I'm gonna try not to spoil anything, but I am going to be showing you all of my matches in the tournament. If I were you, I'd go check Blinky's channel to see if he uploaded the VOD of the actual broadcast before watching mine, because there was actually a professional casting thing at Minecon for this tournament. As in, Blinky casted on a tournament stage with people watching in the audience. So it was probably the biggest Scrolls tournament to date. And you can watch that VOD if it's up. Because my video here today is more about me talking about what I was thinking certain turns. Because obviously Atmez and Blinky can't get into my head halfway across the globe. So if you don't know what the Minecon Open is, there were two qualifying tournaments to get into the finals. There were 8 slots in the finals. Each qualifying tournament would yield 4 people moving on to the finals. Each qualifying tournament had like 50 or 60 people enter. So that was, they were pretty big hits in their own right. And the 8 people to qualify for the finals were Antirad, Xylax, Holofoil, Chief Bromden, me, Jubape, Tajik, and Magpie Man. So 8 very qualified players. Actually 6 Badgers. So the bracket in the finals was a simple single elimination 8-player bracket with a quarterfinal, semifinals, and finals matches. The quarterfinals were best of 3, semifinals were best of 3, and finals were best of 5. So enough of my rambling. Now let's talk about what actually is going on here. Quarterfinals: Antirad beat Xylax 2-1. Chief Bromden beat Holofoil 2-1. Magpie Man beat Tajik 2-1, and I played Jubape, which we are going to start watching right now. So, me versus Jubape, match 1, Decay versus Decay. Keep in mind, I am going first, I'm on the right side, and he is going second, he's on the left side. Oh, I'm sorry, not Decay versus Decay, this is his interesting aggroth build versus my mono Decay. So, I start off with a turn 2 Mire Mare, which is okay. I mean, it's much better with Dominion. A 2-2 for 2 is not very good, but it's nice to have the first creature on the board, and he gets a 4-3-2 for 2, which is able to be destroyed by my Mire Mare, so I'm not really too worried about that, and I could Soul Steal it if I get one. And I place a Harvester down right behind him. Not too great in the early game Harvester, I'd rather have a Rot Eater, but it's still a warm body. Now, Jubape plays a Wildling, which I am actually pretty scared of. I'm afraid he's playing one of those super enchantment decks, and I won't be able to kill the Wildling. So I did consider Damning Cursing the Wildling there, but I ultimately decided not to. Just play a low Darkling for some protection, because it doesn't look like Jubape's going to be making that Wildling huge anytime soon. You see his hand, he goes up to 4, plays a Steelwood Champion, which, because of my Languid, is going to make the Wildling still have 0 attack. So that Languid was very worthwhile. I tossed the Damning Curse for Scrolls here just because Soul Steals are so valuable for his growth, but unfortunately for me, I got a dead draw, so I probably should have kept the Damning Curse maybe and just Damning Curse something. He plays a Kinfolk Veteran to protect his attacking creatures and also take out one of mine. That Wildling not having any attack is very good for me. Still nothing to Soul Steal, but at least I have an Oblivion Seeker to play, so now I have some protection there. And he's going to start being able to take out my creatures. Hopefully not my Harvester, though. I'm just hoping the Harvester survives. And Jubape goes ahead and plays the Earthen Mirth on the Wildling. So now it's actually going to be useful. But now I have a Harvester with 1 countdown. And look at that. I have a Soul Steal in my hand. I was holding on to 2. So that's almost like the game right there. It was like back and forth in the early game. Maybe even better for Jubape. But he was lined up, and there was a thing to Soul Steal, and I just clear his board on round 7. That's really the death sentence for aggroth against Mono Decay. So, I mean, the decks against each other are pretty evenly matched, I think, Mono Decay versus aggroth. But the early game really just showed that a Harvester attacking is going to mean the end of it. And yeah, I'm getting really good draws here. A Harvester Soul Steal there. Nothing Jubape can do, so he's just going to surrender the first match to me, and we'll go to match 2. Here's match two. Since I went first last game, he gets to go first this game. That's the rules for the Minecon Open. And I just need to win one of the next two matches against Jubape to move on to the semifinals. So he is still playing the same aggro deck. We didn't see Border Treaty before, but now you see it. I guess he has that with no IDs just to get some extra damage and a nice little surprise play. I am playing Mono Decay again. So it looks like we both stuck with our same two decks. Not something you see very often in Scrolls tournaments because deck countering is a big part of it. And because he goes first, he's finally able to get a creature before me, a Kinfolk Ranger. He decides not to be greedy and play a Brave, but I didn't even have a Soul Steal in hand, so maybe he should have played the Brave. Yeah, against the K, it's sometimes a good idea just to not play your two health creatures. Jubape goes up and plays the Wildling, so a very good start for him. Looks like I'm going to have to give up that Mire Mare. I do have some 3 drops for protection, so I do that, even though I'm almost hanging them out to dry. And now Jubape can go up to 4. He actually goes for Scrolls, so he can only play one thing. He probably should have gone for Resources there, so he can follow up with a Veteran the following turn, instead of trying to fish for, I'm not sure what he would be able to fish for there. It's not like he can play an Earthen Mirth or anything. So, I catch a little break, he's still at 3 Resources, and I play Cursemonger. Interestingly, Cursemonger is going to protect the 2 not as important creatures, but those have lower health, so I want to get as many attacks off as possible versus Growth. And Jubape goes ahead and plays a Fjords of Vigor. So if he had the Veteran that turn, he'd be able to kill the Cursemonger, but he didn't. But now he has a bunch of creatures that have slightly higher attacks. I do top deck a Soul Steal and Infested Husk, so that was a pretty good top deck, although I had to get rid of Oblivion Seeker. Now I position like this, so if he has a Ragged Wolf or anything, he can't clear all of my attacking creatures. He can only clear, he has to choose, those top two or the bottom two. So he decides to destroy my entire lane there, but keeping my Cursemonger alive, and he gets poisoned, and I draw a scroll from that husk dying. So it was a pretty, I don't really care about my row was clear, that Ranger's dead from my Cursemonger, the sister is going to die from poison, and I drew a scroll. And now I fill up my board around Rot Eater, which is very hard for Growth to deal with. So kind of back and forth in the early game here, and looks like I've taken the advantage. He still has a Wildling, which is a nuisance. He plays the new Breaker. The new Breaker now gets increased by 1 health as well as attack when it attacks. Used to just get increased by attack. There's a Soul Steal. And that's going to really almost be the end for Jubape. When Aggroth loses its control of the game, there's really not much coming back. He just goes for scrolls, gets a couple creatures, I guess hoping he can somehow hold on, but it's really not looking good for him. It's looking like I'm going to get the first 2-0 in the tournament. Everybody else won their matches 2-1. Jubape, probably considered the underdog of the tournament. He's definitely very qualified to be in the tournament. He's a definitely a fantastic player to be able to earn a spot in these finals. But to be honest, he probably doesn't have the same tournament win history as many of the other players in this tournament. So he was a bit of an underdog. Definitely definitely a strong enough player to beat anybody here. We're all elite players here, so everybody shares a decent chance of winning the tournament. He plays the Border Treaty, and I guess that's going to give him high attack. But then I have 2 Mire Shamblers attacking a Harvester, and there's a Brain Lice. So he's going to have to somehow clear that Harvester and the Rot Eater out soon. A lot of attacking creatures. I position like that so that I have a 100% chance of at least destroying 2 creatures. Whether it's the top no ID and the top sister, or it's both sisters. That way I can get rid of both of those. At least 2 of the 3. And now he takes out the Harvester, even though I just left it out there. He takes it out. I didn't really protect it at all. But now I have a 9-9 Rot Eater. And that's going to be hard for him to destroy. I do have a double language, a double brain lice in hand. I can't afford it, so it looks like just a life stealer turn. I am running Morbid Curiosity, one of the buffed cards in the latest balance update, and I think it's pretty good now. You straight up get a card back when your creature with Morbid Curiosity gets destroyed, so it's pretty good. And he plays Steelwood Champion, which does give him a bunch of attack, and my Rod Eater's down to 4 health, so all of a sudden it's looking like Jubabe might have a chance to come back in this game, but then I top deck a Soul Steal. My top deck's definitely very good so far, and yeah, it looked like I might be swinging back, so he's a chance at the game, but then a couple good draws, and he's almost back to square one. He does have a couple lingering spells on the field, so anything he plays will have a decent attack. I mean, his bottom of the board there is like almost just straight up destroyed by those two attacking creatures, the 10 attack Rod Eater. He fills up the bottom lane, and I sacrifice for actually resources here. I just want to get more units on the board. Nothing on his row has 2 health, so it's not like a Soul Steal would help me clear the row. So I just decide to take out the Breaker, and then I have 2 Marish Shamblers. Maybe they can come down and destroy his stuff very soon. So Jubei plays a Keen Warden, not something you see every day. A one drop that can get up to like 4 attack after getting pillage, and he actually is able to clear that row. So he does play a rally to do so. My 10 attack Rod Eater is gone, but now I have 2 Shamblers attacking, and I play 2 very powerful creatures versus growth, Harvester and Rot Eater, and then I position my Shambler so I have a 100% chance of killing one thing, and then a 50% chance, or no, actually a 67%, no, 50%. So it was a 100% chance of killing the Keen Warden, and then a 75% chance of killing the Earthborn Mystic. So I think that was a pretty good way of doing it. I don't think there was a way to have 100% chance on 100% chance. Now it's my turn, and I have 7 resources, so I can Necrogeddon, but I decide not to because I see my board and it has a Rot Eater and a Harvester, which is very hard for growth to deal with. My idols are looking pretty decent, so I don't really have to take creatures out just yet. I know maybe some people would have Necrogeddon here. I didn't see the point because then I'm just setting myself up. If he happens to have a Quake, of course he doesn't, but I didn't know that. I'm just playing the match. And he plays this guy, which does have Inspiring now in the latest update. And there, he's able to take out my 2 Mire Shamblers, which are attacking. I have a 5 attack Rod Eater. And now I just need to destroy 2 creatures to get that Harvester to go off, but I don't have anything to do that. I go ahead, instead of Languiding for more cards, I just play the Witch Doctor because the Witch Doctor is really a pain in the butt for growth to get through, especially a growth deck like his where it doesn't have a lot of Relentless. It just has a lot of like humans attacking, low countdown creatures. So it's gonna be hard for him to get through the Witch Doctor without using a Rumble. He plays a no ID and he's gonna go ahead and play another Border Treaty. So I did move that Ripper up to the top because I was afraid he might be able to snipe that top idol. I didn't want to take any huge chances there. And interesting, he moved down to destroy the Ripper, the Darkling, which then I got a Husk and the Rod Eater is buffed from, so I'm not sure what he was trying to do there. And now I'm able to take out a Ragged Wolf, a Noidi, a Kinfolk Brave, and destroy my second idol. And I have a Necrogeddon in hand, so I'm kind of just waiting for a chance to play that and win the game. So Jubape sacrifices for scrolls, and he has no way of really doing things. He does have a Kinfolk Veteran, which I think he forgot about that Husk. He wouldn't have been able to destroy the Harvester because the Harvester would have had 1 health left. So that's just the Witch Doctor for you. It's hard to destroy stuff like that. And yeah, this was a very early in the morning tournament. I'm not sure where Jubape lives, but here on the East Coast of the United States, I had to wake up at 5 a.m. to play in this thing. But I figured it was worth it. Maybe one of the last big tournaments for Skrulls. So Jubape surrenders, and Mono Decay beats Aggroth with a twist with Border Treaty twice in a row. So I advance to the semifinals 2-0 over Jubabe, and the semifinals matches are Anthony Rad versus Chief Bromden and me versus Magpie Man. Anthony Rad beat Chief Bromden 2-1 in his semifinals match, so Anthony Rad goes to the finals, and we'll watch my matches with Magpie Man. Here is game one, me versus Magpie Man. And I go first. I'm on the left side. I'm playing Aggroth. And he is playing, I believe he's playing Undead Decay. So I do go for a mulligan there, and I get the turn two Brave, which is not great against Decay because of Soul Steal, but it looks like he doesn't have that in his hand, so that's good for me. But he has a great curve of undead creatures, Shambler into Husk into Husk. So now it is back to my turn. I'll play the Brave, and I top deck a Breaker, which is a very good top deck. Now I have a straight curve up to 5. So I put the Brave right in the middle so I can just take down that Mire Shambler if he can't deal with it. But he plays an Infected Husk, which has 3 health, so that's going to be able to deal with it. So already looking not so good for me. Magpie Man, a extremely talented player. He has maybe like the second most ESL wins of all time. So I think this, in the entire tournament, might have been the series of matches which I was most worried for. Because whatever happened in the semis, if I even got there, if Jubabe beat me, this would be different. But I was thinking, if I beat Jubabe, my hardest matches in the tournament might be the winner of Magpie Man and Tajik, two really good players. And there, I play a Steelwood Champion after the loss of my Kinfolk Brave. I use my Kinfolk Brave to block there because some people like to protect that thing at all costs. But he's playing Decay, so I'd rather him get a chance to destroy the 2-health creature right now instead of destroying it later with a Soul Steal. Unfortunately, I have to get rid of my Niara there, and I do go for a Veteran, so I'm using 2 3-attack creatures to destroy 2 1-health creatures, and I'm poisoning myself and summoning 2 Revenants. Luckily, the Revenant did not spawn directly in front of the Conduit, or else that he would be able to destroy my Kinfolk Veteran this turn, so I was a little bit lucky there. On the Revenant spawning, he puts down a Rot Eater, which is a very good play for Magpie Man because that thing is immediately going to be buffed up to 5/5. And now I'm looking through what I have. I have to get rid of another Niara, so I think that's all the Niaras in my deck. The new Niara is a pretty good creature on her own now. I get rid of the 4 health Husk, play a Striped Fang Bear, and a Revenant will spawn right behind the Rot Eater. So it's looking close right now. He has a damning. He sacrifices the damning curse. I guess it could have been used on the breaker, but he ultimately decides to get rid of it. And interesting here, he actually uses the revenant on my poisoned creature, which was going to die from poison before it attacked. Maybe he was scared of a rally, but I don't know. I probably would have put 2 damage on the bear. I guess he saw he had no soul steals in hand, so he didn't really want to. I go for scrolls, and I top deck a great wolf and a mangy wolf, so things might come around for me. I could have put a bunch of damage on the Harvester, that Rot Eater, but I decide to just take out as many creatures as I can because I'm afraid he can play like stuff like Restless Bones with all undead creatures. And there he does play an Urva, so that's going to put 2 damage on my buffed up Breaker, so he's back to 3 health where he started. And unfortunately, maybe I should have put my Great Wolf closer to the middle because I can't get it to attack anywhere with the Mangy Wolf. I do play an Overgrown Menhir. That is really good for just having an onslaught of creatures. Put that down, and all the creatures you'll put down come down with 1 countdown. So I put down a Nog, and he moves up. I guess he's afraid of that. He's afraid of that Great Wolf. And it looks like he's going to be able to deal idle damage faster than me. He has a 10 attack Rot Eater. That's able to one-hit idles. I leave my Nog there because I don't really care about that. It's already getting 2 damage in, and I don't want him to take out middle idle too easily, so I'd actually leave that Nog there. And I have a Striped Fanger attacking next turn because of that Overgrown Menhir. So if he moves out, I can move up and destroy whatever's there. And he plays a Flesh Dude there. I probably would have put it in front of his Urva, because Urva's pretty valuable, but instead he's leaving his Urva for me to be able to destroy, so interesting choice there. He does destroy middle idol there, wasting a bit of damage, but destroying the most important idol. Looks like he's going to be done with the game fast, and I have to, it's really a race for idol damage here. I'm not going to win this It's really whoever's going to destroy all three idols first. I have to win it actually sooner than him, because he probably has direct idol damage. Or maybe, I'm not sure. And he also has revenant stuff, restless bones. So if I'm not careful, he could just win this thing out of the blue. And it's going to be hard for me to destroy that middle idol with 8 health. Really hard. But I do have a giant breaker, 2 big great wolves. So I do have the creatures that deal damage. But I'm really not protecting my top idols at all yet. I sacrificed a rally for scrolls there, which immediately after I sacrificed that, I was like, oh crap, I shouldn't have done that. I'm probably going to need that rally to make that breaker attack with a huge attack. So I immediately regret that, but I do get a couple braves that come down with haste next to the overgrown mentor. And that means that there's going to be a couple revenants coming down, and I'm able to almost destroy an idol, and that giant rot eater is now 13 attack, 2 health, so I do get it down a lot. He has a Soul Seal, Restless Bones, Infected Husk, and Blade Husk. So certainly lots of options to work with. He plays the Infected Husk for some protection. And he plays a Restless Bones. So that Restless Bones is going to put him within 1 damage of lethal. So I'm hanging on by a thread. But he maybe didn't protect his idols that well. Because I actually get so lucky and top deck a Rally. So I can put down a Vetter and Rally. And believe it or not, this is lethal. So I didn't even expect it to be lethal. I was thinking that a revenant would spawn in my way. So I was thinking there's a 25% chance it was lethal, but it actually was. So I won the game after he put that idol at 1 health. So Magpie Man must have been feeling pretty upset after that loss. It was his game to lose, or his game to win. He had that win in the bag if he just had 1 extra health on that middle idol protecting it, and he would have won for sure next turn or something like that. So I guess he miscalculated, thinking I couldn't win with a rally, but luckily for me, I sacrificed that rally and immediately saved by the scrolls gods and given another rally to work with. So on to match 2, me versus Magpie Man. I just need to win 1 of the next 2 games versus him to move on to the finals, the grand finals. And he goes first because I went first game 1. He looks like he's still playing the same Undead Decay deck. And he keeps his starting hand, gets rid of the early Urva, interesting. And he doesn't have a 3 drop, but probably good enough starting hand to keep, especially he's going first. I switched to Automatons, which sometimes aren't that strong against Undead Decay, but I wasn't really expecting him to play Undead Decay again. I was playing the counter game, he didn't, and it looks like it might be good for him, because automatons don't do that well against Undead Decay. Sometimes they can just rush automatons down, but I do have a good early curve here. I'm able to get rid of something with my Copper Auto, and then I play a Canister Automaton, which would be able to trade with a lot of undead creatures, but a lot of them have only melee creatures. And he goes for 50% chance to destroy that, but he unfortunately for him does not get it. He definitely wanted to make that trade because he's only losing a 1 drop, I'm losing a 2 drop, and also he's buffing his Rot Eater to 4 health. And that is very important for 2 reasons: burn and potency burst on 4 energy. He plays a Flesh Animator that has 4 health, so I can survive that kind of stuff. But I do have the Potency Burst, and I go ahead and get rid of the Battle Dance to play it, and it's looking good for me. In the early game, if my deck can sustain board control, it's going to be very hard for him to survive. He plays Sanctuary of the Lost, which was slightly buffed. All his undead creatures, basically his whole deck, has Magic Resistance and Ward, which is very important against energy, because energy has a lot of direct damage and removal, so board makes that kind of hard to do. And yeah, Magpie Man, upset by that Shambler movement, and you know, little plays like that could mean the difference in games. Elite player versus elite player, it's really going to come down to maybe the luck one player gets in their draws, or RNG elements on the field. And there I do play a Stone Enigma, which bumps me up to 5 energy and gets rid of Sanctuary of the Lost. So I ran that Anti-Linger for reasons like this. He gets down a Animal Conduit, which is really powerful, But look at my hand, I have a Thunder Surge, which I actually wouldn't have been able to play if I didn't play the Stone Enemy the turn before and get more energy. So that was very good for me. Not looking good for Magpie Man. Looks like he didn't want to play another Sanctuary of the Lost because my Ekomaton would go up to 3 attack. And now I'm going to be able to... he actually got range damage in with that Urba, so that's a pretty good way of destroying my Canister Automaton. But I do have another Canister Automaton. I actually play a Blast Automaton this turn instead, just taking advantage of the resources on my turn, and a Copper Automaton, so I'm putting the pressure on. He does not have a Soul Steal to destroy that, so Magpie Man not getting the best draws here. He's going to try to protect his Urba. He really didn't do a lot of idle damage yet either. Decides not to play the Sanctuary of the Lost because of the Ekomaton would go up to 3 attack. I burn him and then use the Copper Automaton to kill that. So that was really just a slap in the face to Magpie Man because he didn't play the Sanctuary of the Lost. I was able to burn his Slayer Vestige and clear his board. So now I have the board control. I'm Automatons. Undead Decay does not really have a way of coming back into the game. And he's basically dead. So I didn't think that I would 2-0 sweep Magpie Man. He's a really, really strong player. But the fact of the matter is just my draws were better. And I guess it was good that, I'm not going to lie, I've had a lot of luck in my time playing Skrulls. And I guess I'm fortunate that the Skrulls gods didn't let me down on the big tournament stage. So he's trying to hold on just a bit longer, but you look at what I sacrifice. So I play that, and that's going to allow me to almost clear his board. And he doesn't really see anything he wants to play, so he's just going to surrender. And I move on to the final. So unfortunately for Magpie Man, he gets 2-0'd by me, and the finals are Antirad versus NRP 1-2-3. And I have the only two 2-0s in the whole tournament. The rest of the matches played were 2-1s, so I am surprised by that. I guess I'm putting pretty well at 5 o'clock in the morning here. So on to the finals. Game 1 of the finals, Antirad goes first. He is playing Mono Decay, and he has a lot of 2-drops to play, so he keeps his hand, and now it is my turn, and I'm also playing Mono Decay. So I mulligan, and I have a 2-drop into 3-drop into 4-drop, so it's pretty good. Both of us has pretty decent hands. Mono Decay versus Mono Decay, these kind of mirror matches sometimes are the very best matches you see in Skrulls. So back and forth, no player is usually out of it, so this is the makings for a really entertaining first game of the finals. So remember, the finals are best of 5, and the first turn switches off every match. So Antirad has 2 units on the board before I do, but my creatures are slightly better because I have a Harvester now. Harvester, like I said a couple matches ago, not amazing in the early game, but still might get an attack off. So he gets a Infested Husk down, he's able to play an Oblivion Seeker the next turn. So he's going to get creatures on the field that I don't really want to destroy. I go ahead and go to 4 resources to play the Blightbearer, seeing that next turn I can go to 5 and play a Linguid and a Harvester. And I'm not expecting anything to die in the board right now, so the Harvester, another Harvester on the field wouldn't really do anything. He gets an Oblivion Seeker down, puts 2 damage on my Infected Husk. I go ahead and Linguid. I decide to keep hold of the Soul Steal, just be a Soul Steal, such an amazing card. I can just Soul Steal his Infected Husk next turn and count down both my Harvesters by 2, or by 1. So I get rid of a pretty good card to keep that. And he has a Linguid Infested Husk, so he can't destroy anything. I mean, I guess it didn't really matter if I did Linguid him, because I almost want my Husk to die so my Harvesters can count down. Now it's back to my turn. I get rid of the Necrogeddon, and I top deck Oblivion Seeker, but this turn looks like it's going to be a Soul Steal turn, because I wanted to destroy 2 creatures. I destroyed the Oblivion Seeker and his Infected Husk, and I was really lucky, actually, that the poison from his Infected Husk went on my Blightbearer. That was very lucky. It had a 40% chance of landing one of my harvesters, which I did not want to happen. Because that just means harvester is going to die in like 3 or 4 turns. And probably not get an attack off. And so he gets down 2 powerful creatures right near our harvester. So now it's looking like he might be coming ahead, even though I looked like I was ahead. But I get an Oblivion Seeker down, and what Blinky always says, the player who plays more Oblivion Seekers in the Decay Mirror match will probably win the game. So now we're tied in Oblivion Seeker plays. He curses my harvester, but he does not have a Brain Lice to take it out. So that is very good for me. And he takes out my Mire Shambler, and because of the poison on my Bloodbear is going to die when he attacks. So very good for me. I'd get rid of the Mire Mare early on. And I top deck a Necrogeddon, so I have a Necrogeddon Watcher, or a Watchergeddon for later in the game. Easy choice here, I play the Oblivion Seeker. I guess that turn I could have went for 6 and played Oblivion Seeker Ripper, but I wanted to see what I get for Scrolls. I use the Blightbear to poison his Harvester and deal 2 damage to it, so that's going to ensure it dies. But he destroys one of my Harvesters, the non-cursed one, and Languids my other one, so that was a good turn for him. He can really mitigate the damage I can deal to him, and he destroys the husk, which poisons him, but it poisons, of all things, it poisons the infected husk, which is going to die this turn no matter what. I get a Brain Lice and a Ripper down. The Brain Lice is going to allow me to destroy that Witch Doctor, so not too bad. I have 2 Oblivion Seekers down the board. I'm going to play my 3rd the next turn. Or no, this is Antier. No, that was, never mind. I can play 3 Oblivion Seekers. See, he's packing the Unbind Corpse Theft combo, probably. He goes ahead and plays a Brain Lance. That's going to be that Harvester is probably going to die before getting another attack off. And he decides not to curse it, seeing it's probably going to die to the poison eventually. No, it already is cursed, so he doesn't really need to curse it. He puts 3 damage on the idol, so I guess he didn't really want to curse any of my creatures. He's more focused on getting idol damage, but that allows me to just put a Witch Doctor down, which is going to mean it's going to be harder to destroy all those humans on my board. So maybe he regrets that. Maybe he wishes he cursed that Oblivion Seeker and killed it before the Witch Doctor was down. He does play a Brain Lice, which means that Cursemonger can curse it next turn, which means our Witch Doctor could be dead in a matter of time. And now I look at my hand. I have a Necrogeddon. So that is definitely an option. But instead I play the 2 creatures because I can't really destroy both of his top creatures, so the Necrogeddon doesn't seem too good here. And it's not like that poison's gonna kill my Oblivion Seeker and I won't have another creature to Necro, because I will get a husk to use that. And he goes ahead and curses my Witch Doctor, but it's going to survive for 1 turn. And he brainlesses like my whole field. So this is a perfect time to Necrogeddon for me, because the units on my side of the board are going to be dead in a matter of time anyways. And the Harvester could have been bad news for me in terms of a Necrogeddon, because then if I couldn't destroy him, he'd attack. But he goes in the front there, so I am able to destroy him. And I top deck a Ripper. Amazing top deck there. Like I said, top decks are with me in this tournament. And I am able to clear his board with that Necro. And that Rod Eater has 3 health, and I position in a way where it's not going to be buffed to 4 health until after it would have been destroyed. So that was pretty much a lucky, perfect Necro on round 12 to clear Anti-Rad's board. So I'm at 1 more resource than him. After that play, it looks like I am clearly, I clearly have the advantage in this Decay Mirror match. But like I said, he can definitely come back with the right draws. And Anti-Rad looks at his hand. He plays a Cursemonger Pack Husk. Interesting choice. I probably would have chosen just the Oblivion Seeker Pack Husk just to get more out of my resources, but I don't really doubt anything Anti-Rad does. He is one of the great players of Scrolls. Probably Anti-Rad is the next most successful ranked player after me, I think. Like, I think he is the next most, like, number one ranking, and he's always, like, near the top with his accounts, Rock Jesus and Anti-Rad. So I get our Harvester down, and I keep confusing those two. I get a Rod Eater down around all the Husks, so that was a very good draw for me. Now, if the Husks die, I'll have a nice powerful creature. He gets a Rod Eater down. I am really confusing these cards. He gets a Harvester down and an Oblivion Seeker down. I never used to do this. I always know what a Rod Eater and a Harvester are. I don't know why I'm doing this during this casting. I do get a brain lice. I actually double brain lice it. I'm really afraid of that harvester attacking me. It can destroy lots of two elf husks at once. Maybe not the right play there. Maybe I should have just put the brain lices on different things, because the harvester probably wouldn't have attacked with a single brain lice on it. But I definitely want to destroy that thing. But he has a Necrogun. So that means with the curse on the harvester, oh my god, the curse on the rot eater, he is able to destroy it. And he draws some cards from his husk and his Oblivion Seeker. So pretty good Necrogun for him. But it's at the point in the game where if his Necrogun didn't clear my board, I'm probably still ahead in the match, because he's destroying my Oblivion Seeker here, and I still have a few husks attacking to kill most of his husks he just attacked with. And I have a turn here to put more things on the board. So, yeah, my hand is huge now after that Oblivion Seeker died. I go ahead and just play the double Rot Eater Loyal Darkling play. I could have played the Witch Doctor, but there's no humans on the board yet, so I felt like I just wanted to play the husks and the Rot Eaters in case of another Necrogun. Even though another Necrogun was very unlucky, because he only has a couple creatures on the board. He does have another Necrogun in hand. He keeps hold of that wisely and plays a Rot Eater and another Rot Eater. And does he have enough to play the Trizin? Yes, he does. So he's filling up the board. Pretty good for him. But now it's my turn, and I can really get the big Witch Doctor out. I go to 10 resources. Because I want to make sure I can play a human in front of it. Cursemonger, usually not a protector unit, because it's really valuable. But it's a human, and I gotta play a human in front of that Witch Doctor. Maybe I should have had that Loyal Darkling closer to the front, so he can go in front. And Anti-Rad plays a Draining Mist to stop both of my Rot Eaters from attacking. So that's really the difference of our decks, I think. He has Draining Mists, I have Watchers. I believe that's the difference. And our boards look very similar here, so like I said, Decay can come back. But I have a Watcher again, and I actually sacrifice it. I think some people were surprised I sacrificed the Watcher there. But I think all my units I had are more important, because he has full health idols, he has a Witch Doctor down. That's really the key. If he didn't have a Witch Doctor down, I probably would have Watcher again, because then I can just plow through, destroy his Watchers, and get a bunch of idol damage. With the Witch Doctor, I can't touch anything on his board, besides like one Rot Eater. So that's why I didn't do that. He gets a Damning Curse, and now it's looking like he might be in good shape. But I still have a Necrogun if I need it. I see what I have in my hands, and I do have a Damning Curse, which could be big on the Witch Doctor, because it would allow me to destroy that back Rot Eater. So I go ahead and play it. My Mire Shambler does die, but I get the buffs on both Rot Eaters, and I play a Cursemonger. So Damning Curse for Damning Curse, we both kill each other's Witch Doctors, and he's left with a huge Rot Eater. I'm left with more strong creatures than him. Oh no, was that a Watcher? So maybe he does run Watcher. He plays a Oblivion Seeker and a Light Bearer. So putting down things that's going to be tough for me to destroy, but I know I'm going to have to destroy them. So I decide just to, after a sacrifice of scrolls, I see a Brain Lice, which could be good for whittling down the health of something. And I'm able to destroy one of the Blight Bearers with one Rot Eater. I decide to make the trade, because the Rot Eater will probably get another attack off. I take out the Oblivion Seeker and put Brain Lice on his giant Rot Eater. Maybe he didn't need to put Brain Lice on that, seeing as it's really going to take a long time to die from the Brain Lice. Maybe I should have waited for another Damning Curse. Interesting to note, I only run two Damning Curses. I just don't like it that much because of the taxing, and also it deals damage to your side, which sometimes helps, but I don't know. I've always just not been a huge fan of playing Damning Curse. I just love my Soul Seals. So he plays three more units on the board, and now I have to figure out how to destroy that stuff. I do have a Soul Seal, but he doesn't really have anything to Soul Seal. He hasn't had something to Soul Seal for a while. I have a Damning Curse out, so I can get rid of his giant Rot Eater, which is tempting, but it's not attacking this turn. Decay doesn't have any countdown reduction, so I guess it has some, but like not in this case in our decks. So I don't really feel the need to Damning Curse that giant Rot Eater yet, and he does have a Witch Doctor. But yeah, he's, or no, does he, no, he Necrogun's this turn. This I thought was a weird Necrogun. It doesn't really accomplish that much. I guess the double poison on the rod eater back there means it will die before getting an attack off. But I'm still surviving with my giant rod eater and back husks. Or no, he destroys one husk, but by positioning this way, I think he makes a misplay here, because both my rod eaters will survive. Because he's destroying something around it. And yeah, I was not really a huge fan of that Necrogen, but I really guess, what else did he really have to do? It looked like he was on the ropes there. I was gaining the lead, and I decide not to put 10 damage on a husk. I just want to end this game sooner. So I put 10 damage on an idol and just take it out. And I believe around here, on 21, the actual broadcast of the tournament, there was a spectate bug, unfortunately. So maybe watch here if you missed that and you could see what happened in the rest of the game. So there is an Illmire Witch Doctor and a Languid coming down on that husk. Really, on the husk, just doesn't really do a whole lot though. Probably isn't even going to get another attack off. And both those husks for him are going to die of poison. It's my turn. I have a Necrogen and a little Darkling, so it looks like I'm just looking for a chance to win the game, an opening. I don't see one yet, so I decide to the Damning Curse his Witch Doctor and play a Witch Doctor of my own. So now I have a 12 attack Rod Eater attacking. He does have a Damning Curse, but I have 3 valuable Damning Curse units on the board. Easy choice to get rid of the Rod Eater, though, but now that takes a lot of his resources for the turn. 6 resources, or 7 actually. No, 6. And then now I finally... no, it's not the win. I thought it might be the win. It's not a win. If I had another little Darkling or a Watcher, it would probably be the win. So instead I play double Oblivion Seekers. But he's still really, he's really on the ropes here. I'm just clearing his board, almost turn after turn. I have more resources in him. I've done more idle damage. This is where, I guess the matches missed by spectate mode weren't, the rounds missed by spectate mode weren't really that important. He does finally not protect all the idols this turn, so I do have a win. I have the win in hand. I just have the little Darkling on the bottom row and Necrogeddon. And that is GG. So I'm very happy to go on a 1-0 advantage in the finals, especially on a game where I went second. So I win the Decay Mirror match, and feeling very good about my chances to take home all the awesome prizes from this. I'll say the prizes at the end of the video. And that is game one. So game two, I'm thinking of what I want to switch to. And I know Anti-Rad's bread and butter is his order, usually his tempo order. So we'll see what I play in match two. And what do you know, I play tempo order. Because he went first for game one, I knew I'd go first for game two. So I think, what a better time, there's probably not a better time to play something like tempo order where turn one advantage is huge. And he is playing, looks like late game-ish order, but he has a lot of tempo elements like Proud Mercenary, Roast of Bean Potion, stuff like that. So he looks like he has a hybrid build. I kept my starting hand even though it didn't have a 2-drop. Yeah, so he looks like more late game order, but from my looks of it, and I'll tell you right now, when I was playing, I thought he was playing tempo order. I mean, that Kabank is more late game, but I just see the units he plays early on, and I think this is tempo order. So I'm thinking I have to just control the board and I'll win this thing. And I thought that was probably going to be easy because I have the first 2 units on the board. Yes, but he played the Proud Mercenary here. I'm thinking he's playing tempo order. So I'm able to play a 4-drop now. So definitely very good for me. There's Faith Blessing, which really is Decimations 4 through 6 now because of the buff. I put 3 damage in the middle idol, decide not to engage him. I know idol damage is key in this matchup. Tempo order versus tempo order comes down a lot to luck. But like I said, I thought it was tempo order versus tempo order, but he's actually late game order. Which I guess could be good actually though, because tempo order is really fast and late game order is pretty slow, so I might have enough time to just win the game. But he does have Imperial Resources, which can heal his idols, which kind of puts less of an effect on Decimations and Faith Blessings. I get down a Dugal Spearman there just to protect that middle lane, and he has a choice if he wants to get rid of that thing or not. I got he will this turn. He'd have to like play Blessing of Haste. And he plays a Rolleros. Yeah, so I'm still thinking all the way he's playing tempo order. Very convincing deck by Anti-Rad. So I'm able to play another Dugal Skirmish here. It was very interesting. He just let his Rolleros die. I'm not sure why he did that. I guess, yeah, he can kill my skirmisher if he has like a focus or something, but he doesn't even have a focus. So I'm kind of confused with that. He does get the finally second Kabank to take care of that aging knight. And he has a mangonel tempo theft in his hand, so I am not expecting that. I think he's playing tempo order. And so I'm not gonna play around it either. I'm not thinking about it at all. I top deck a Ralloros, but that's not the play for this turn. A decimation is pretty perfect because I can destroy his Ducal Skirmisher with only one health because of the it took Spiky damage. But now he's able to go with a mangonel tempo theft, which doesn't do that much. It destroys a couple of my creatures, but that's a fine. It's really an okay trade. I mean, it's a 2-for-2 trade. It's a good play for him, but it's not devastating for me. I sacrifice up to 6. I play a or sacrifice 5. I play a Ralloros just because I want to keep up with him in resources. Yeah, but man, that mangonel really threw me off. I'm like, what? This isn't tempo order. He plays an Arbalest Deer here, making use of his resources. And he plays it right back there, protecting Metal Idol. Probably doesn't want me to get Dominion very easily. But I top deck a Focus. Like I said, my top decks are with me in this tournament. So I can play Roasted Meat Potion, Focus, and a Royal Skirmisher, which is going to give me 8 attack because of that Ralloros, and clear his board. So now he has to work from behind, Ancyrad does, and try to survive here. He has Gallant Defender, which is pretty good for surviving because it has armor 2 whenever I have more creatures than him, and I definitely gonna have more creatures than him. I get rid of the Scout for Skrulls, and I get not very good draws, dead draws. I pother again just to see if I can play a unit this turn. Maybe pointless pothers, but then look at that. I top deck a Ducal Infantryman. That's my luck this tournament. That allows me to play creature this turn and get Dominion this turn, which is important because of I have favored in this deck, which is huge with Dominion. And yeah, actually, I think that's the only Dominion thing I have, but that is very important, favored, the enchantment. He plays a second Gallant Defender, so now I'm thinking I need to find a Focus or a Favor to get massive damage. And look at that, I top deck a Favored. My top decks. So I play the Favored, now I have a huge Skirmisher, and I play an Expedition Guard. Not so good against Order decks because Order plays mostly humans, but he's still a 4 health 3 drop, so he's not terrible. And now Ancyrad has to figure out something. He just goes up, plays the Imperial Resources. He has an Arbalest Deer Tempo Theft he could play next turn, but it's really going to be the end for Ancyrad. I have Lethal in my hands. I have a Blessing of Haste on a Proud Mercenary. That's game. He doesn't want to see himself get blown up, so he decides to just surrender. That Skirmisher did go down to 9 health when I moved up, but remember, I could have just played this Proud Mercenary, so he was dead anyways. So that's a 2-0 lead for me, and Ancyrad has to win the next 3 games to be the champion of this tournament. And I knew I would probably have to screw up to let that happen. So I'm just trying to stay focused and win one of the next 3 games to take home all the prizes. So game 3, Ancyrad goes first once again. He is playing tempo order now. So he still plays order, goes down to probably his favorite deck, tempo order, and he goes first, which was like my reasoning when I played Tempo Order last game. And I play Automatons once again. So these finals, I play 3 different decks so far. He's able to get 2 units on the board before I do, so that's not very good. There's the new Winged Soldier with Creature Strike too. Very interesting. Deals a little less idle damage though, so I don't really like it. And my hand is decent. I don't really have a turn 3 play. I guess I could play Copper Auto. But the burn really makes this hand really good. He plays a Wing Shield, which is burnable. I think if I were him, I would just play the Expedition Guard because it can get really big versus Automatons because I'm not going to play any humans. I top deck a Canister Automaton. Like I said, my top deck's this tournament. That's going to allow me to play the Copper Automaton too and really set up my board to kill him. He top decks a Proud Mercenary, which is a pretty decent counter, but still not too great. He's able to get rid of my Gun Automaton, but I still have a Copper Automaton to destroy something, and I have a burn as well. So I get rid of the Stone Enigma. I'm not sure what lingering spells he runs. Order Temple Order tends to run the whatever it's called, the thing that gives magic armor and plus one attack to all your humans, that thing, Grounds of the Fallen. And some, I've seen some new order decks run that new Just Conviction, where it adds the attack to adjacent creatures. But he's able to just put things on the board here, so that's not too good for me. I'm going to have to try to contest his board control, because I don't want him to deal idle damage too fast, because that's what Tempo Order can really do, and you'll lose before you know it. And he goes ahead and plays a Wings Captain, so he's getting four drops to play every turn. Not good for me. I have a Blast on Maton, though, which has armor too, so it might be a bit hard to destroy, but just a single focus on that Butcher dude would destroy it. I get down XCOG, which might be a little slow at this stage. It's 6 resources now after the patch, but I play it anyways. I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to win this. And he pothers the Blast Auto, which was a interesting pother. I'm not sure why he did that. Just let me move towards the middle of the board. And he's not able to destroy it, so he's just going to deal a bunch of idle damage. And now it's my turn. I have another Stone Enigma, I sacrifice it for Scrolls, and I top deck some nice removal. So that Thunder Surge is going to allow me to clear his whole bottom of the board, and now it's looking like I might be able to get a clean sweep of Anti-Red. And actually, the whole tournament, every match in this tournament has not been a sweep, except for mine, I guess, because I went 2-0 game 1, 2-0 game 2-0 versus McCormick in the semis, and if I win this, I can go with I can win 3-0, but it's looking like he is holding on. He plays a Ducal Skirmisher, which is definitely a pain in the butt to deal with. I pump up my XCOG, so the XCOG, I'm not sure, I think if I were him, I would have destroyed the XCOG instead of just dealing much idle damage. Because I know a Temporal likes to deal idle damage, but that XCOG, if you don't destroy it, it's just going to be bad news. Now he has a board full of units. I'm hoping for another Thunder Surge, but I do have a Sudden Eruption in hand, which I can go to 8 and play. That wouldn't allow me to destroy either attacking creature, but I decided to do it anyways, because I can take out 2 creatures and whittle their health down. So, it's an okay turn for me. I'm just trying to see if I can win this game and just come away from this tournament with a win. But Anti-Red wastes 3 damage. Very interesting there. I'm not sure why he would do that. I know he has Decimations, maybe even Faith Blessings to destroy that middle idol. But why not destroy that idol with your Skirmisher and then leave all the Decimations for another idol? So very interesting by him. I actually top decked a Sudden Eruption that turn, but I sacrificed it for Scrolls because I wanted to be greedy. And I guess I shouldn't have been, because the Sudden Eruption would have cleared his board. So now, Anti-Red has not really good draws. He has a Blessing of Haste focus, but yeah, that's going to be able to... Oh, actually, I forgot this turn. This turn actually is a pretty good draw, because Blessing of Haste focus is actually going to be able to let him put 9 damage on that top idol, which means he just needs to draw another Decimation to win the game. He already has one in his hand. And here is where maybe he made a mistake by wasting his 3 damage on a non-existent idol, because that middle idol would be destroyed and then the Decimation would win the game. Again, maybe that wouldn't have happened, but I don't know. But now I have a 9 attack Akumatan, and it's a race for him to find his 3rd Decimation and me to win the game. It's hard for me to put down a lot of damage to the automatons, because my only countdown reduction is Battle Dance and I don't have any in hand right now. So I'm trying to see if I can win this. I top deck a Cannon Auto, I get rid of that, play a Thunder Surge, and pump my XCOG, because I say I don't really want to destroy that 2 health Skirmisher, I have to win the game. He probably has Decimation in hand right now, and if I'm going to win this, I have to win this fast. So, it's another race to destroy the idols, similar to my first match versus Macman, where I was Aggroth versus his Undead Decay, and he doesn't really have a lot to do, so he decides to just surrender. And that is the win for me. Just quick thing to say there. Anti-Red could have delayed my win maybe for another turn by flipping my Cannon Automaton down to the bottom. But he was just feeling discouraged, so he surrendered there. So he could have bought himself one more turn to find a Decimation. But then again, I could have just top decked a Battle Dancer, a Solemn Giant there, and won the game. So that's it. I swept the tournament. I went 7-0. I'm very happy with how I played, and I am very excited that I won a bunch of awesome prizes. So what I got was first the in-game stuff, 25,000 gold, doesn't really matter, a lot of gold, 20 tier 3 scrolls of my choice. I mean, that's cool, but all this in-game stuff, I don't know, it feels like it doesn't really matter a whole lot to me anymore, the in-game stuff, but 20 tier 3 scrolls is definitely a lot. The new tournament head, which I'll probably be wearing for the rest of my time in scrolls, because it's pretty exclusive. A scrolls Minecraft cape, which I already have on my Minecraft account, because I think it's the same Minecraft cape as you get when you get 5 number one weekly winners. And now here's the cool stuff. A scrolls t-shirt, so that's kind of cool. I don't have a scrolls t-shirt, so it's nice to take home some merchandise. A Ducal Skirmisher postcard signed by the Skrulls team. This is one of the best things about it. I really want to get this. If Skrulls is going under, I really want to at least have some things to remember it by, and almost like trophy to show all the time I put into Skrulls and my accomplishments in Skrulls. So a signatures of the Skrulls team on a Ducal Skirmisher postcard, which is actually one of my favorite units, is really cool. And then finally, the grand prize that only I get. Like all the stuff I said so far, a lot of that second place gets as well. But the grand prize that I get is the one-of-a-kind painting by Carnalizer, the lead artist for Skrulls. Carnalizer painted the Skrull Focus, and I'll be getting sent that painting. I'll hang that up, and I'll be very proud of that. That will be my trophy of Skrulls. So I am very, very, very happy I won this thing. It really lightened my mood after the recent news of Skrulls. Now at least I have stuff to remember it by. And yeah, so make sure you check out Blinky's VODs of the stuff if you want to see the live tournament broadcast. And that'll be it. So like the video if you enjoyed, subscribe for more content, and keep on scrolling, Scrollers. There might not be a lot of time left.